Okay, so thank you. So it seems that many of you are coming from Europe and some from Africa. One person actually from Africa, number 7763. I hope you have a name too, but maybe internet connections are not so easy there. So good afternoon to everyone, because I think the part of the map we have is for the afternoon, if not the night. Nobody from Australia. And my idea was to have this interactive session for a bit of discussion and stimulus into problems related to the detection from satellites of features on the surface. I don't know how much it's going to fit your expectations, but you can always ask whatever you want anytime. Please use the chat or raise a hand, and if somebody paying attention will ask me to stop. So, well, I saw some quizzes you had already in the course, and actually this question, one of the questions refers to the visible channels. I have to say, I don't like the term visible for channels. Visible is wavelengths in between 0.4 microns and 0.7 microns, which the eye can receive. But it doesn't mean we cannot see other wavelengths, even infrared wavelengths through imagery. That's why we have satellites and sensors which respond specifically to longer or even shorter wavelengths. So I prefer to say wavelengths coming from the sun are solar channels, and wavelengths coming from the earth are rather infrared channels. That's the theory. I hope you have this concept very clear in your minds, although it can get complicated for intermediate channels, like channels around 3.8 microns, 3.9, where you have not only radiation from the sun, but radiation from the earth. So it's both sources of radiation reaching together. At the same time, the sensors in the satellite for channel 3. Whatever. Okay, you're answering some of the questions, and in fact, yes, I tend to agree with, well, since you can only answer once, but if we go to question B, how many severity channels collect solar radiation? Yes, I think the good answer is 5 or more, because actually we have 3 channels which are clearly solar channels, 0.6, 0.8 and 1.6 micron, but then you have this 3.9 and even the high resolution visible channel. And even if you allow me, I think it's still possible to get some of the reflection from the sun on the channel at 6.2 microns. How many do you use at work? Number C, that's more interesting to know. If you go to question, let us see. Can you answer there? 4 or more? Are you sure you use them all? I don't know if I should believe here, but that would be very good. Actually, solar channels are redundant, yeah? So it's almost the same information on channel 0.6 and on channel 0.8, except for specific areas like growing vegetation, where the differences are substantial. But yes, typically you have to work with differences between channels. That's what we will try to do very quickly now. You have a table here, standard. I think it's the oldest table I know I use. It was done in before the second generation was launched in the previous century, actually. Still, yeah, it's a good reference, I think. So you see the point, if you see the red dot, which is my pointer, the channels in the solar domain around 1 micron, they are mainly behaving as scattering. They scatter in the surfaces or in aerosols in the atmosphere, even scattering in molecules in the air. This is the latter is the fairly scattering, and that changes a bit. It's responsible, for instance, for the blue color of the skies. And I know you have answered many questions on this topic, somebody was asking the other day. And for emissivity, high values of emissivity are found for longer wavelengths. So emissivity is more the behavior of infrared channels, especially the split window, which is based on two or more channels in the maximum, let's say in the peak of emissivity by an Earth at 300 Kelvin, which is the roughly the temperature we have now in the air too. Okay. Any questions? No. You're not. You answered already this. I will go very quickly through that. You know that this is which kind of an image? Do you think it's a solar image? Yes or no? Can you put your arrow close to the yes or no? You have an indication, it's the Mediterranean Sea, it's late in the afternoon. And there seems to be some kind of agreement on this being solar, which is good, especially if you consider the dark areas here, that's already the night. And in addition, you can see a lot more detail in the cloud structure than you can see with infrared. Why? Because we are talking of an albedo field which responds to the shape of the cloud, and the infrared responds to the temperature, which is, let's say, more uniform in space. There are many other details which indicate the actual nature of this image, especially considering that solar imagery responds to reflectivity, so the ocean or the sea reflectivity is low, and you see this, you see black as opposed to the reflectivity of cloud, which is very high. I don't know what I can do to stop the. Let me close my application. Okay. Now, you see shapes sometimes in solar images, especially at sunrise and sunset. You see sometimes the 3D or three-dimensional structure of cloud systems, which is very useful to analyze the strength or the height of these systems, convection.
I'm sorry, Jose, we have one hand risen.
Nothing to be sorry about.
From one number, I don't know who that is, but I will give you the right to speak now, so you can ask your question.
Mr. Edward Falanga. Go ahead, please.
Yes, my first one, this is 7 PMH. I want to find out what are these shapes which are different. I'm sure you are seeing my arrow here. There are these shapes which are different. These 1, 2, 3. What could be this?
Shapes. I'm referring probably to the mountain area where you see some little black lines in a way, which is the shade of the mountains. That's orography shades. And cloud shades are probably in areas like, let me search for them, maybe over here, especially here, it's like black slot behind the cloud, which is, well, it could be the ocean surface in this case, but maybe over here you see some darker lines behind the cloud, which is the shade. Low cloud, is that the answer, or are you not happy with that? You want to dispute it?
No, I'm asking about the shades in the bottom right. You are seeing the bottom right. There's this shade here, another shade here, another shade here. Like they are layers. Now I don't understand what they be. On the bottom right corner, I'm seeing where my pointer is.
Bottom right is here for me. Is it? Do you mean this?
Yes. There's this shade.
Okay, yeah, this.
And there's this shade, they're different.
Yeah, actually, it's darkness because the time of the day is 16 UTC, and that means it's starting night for this area, for the eastern part of the image. So, no radiation from the sun, and what we are picking with this solar channel is radiation from the sun into the satellite sensors. So if there's no sun, there's no reflection, and there's no signal for the satellite, and we convert that into a low value of radiance, obviously, which is black in this case for solar images. For the infrared, we use the opposite criterion. When the radiance is very poor, is not enough, we turn it into white shades. That's an option we have. But in this case, it's night. You could see things in the infrared image, which unfortunately I don't have for this case, but it's, I think it's in the original, but not in this. In this uploaded version. Are you happy with the answer? Or if you want to, yeah?
Yeah, that's fine. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So, feel encouraged to ask any moment. And well, the special solar features I wanted to show refer to, sometimes you say, okay, I should not speak about the atmosphere and the clouds and the aerosol, but of course, if you want to know if something belongs to the surface, you have to know how it looks, how the cloud looks, because it's something you have to separate from the ground. And you say, okay, this is white, but this is cloud and this is snow on the ground. So what's the difference? On this channel, there's no difference, except for the little structure following the valleys. Probably the valleys are a bit warmer, there's no snow, and then you see this dendritic structure which corresponds to rivers, I guess, and valleys. However, although that's a good indication, the texture of the white, it's not always a final indication. For instance, you have a lot of lines here. This is a composite image of three channels, but it's similar. It's in the solar channel, in the solar domain. And you have dendritic structures. What do you think these mountains are? If you look at the coordinates, this is ocean. So let's say the ice is creating these shapes. I don't know by which forces, but it's able to generate filament cloud, and it's good in changing, let's say, cheating or making us think that we are looking at mountains. It's not mountains, it's not snow on the ground, it's cloud. Okay, this is all cloud, this is because the background is ocean. Okay, I'd like to ask you, we are looking here at solar channels. This refers to the three standard channels in EUMETSAT, 0.6, 0.8, 1.6, and this is the high resolution in the horizontal, but low resolution spectrally because it covers from a wide range of wavelengths. So let's say this is for a period around 10:45. Let's say this is 10 and this is 12. And this is the evolution in time for the values of albedo measured in the vertical. For a pixel close to Madrid and for a pixel close to London. So what do you think the weather is like in Madrid and London? So if I ask you, do you think it's let me ask in a clever way, which of the two might contain cloud, Madrid or Lenin, around this time? Use your Madrid, London, that's easy, you have to, more votes we need. Think about cloud albedos, which is what we measure with these channels. Cloud albedo is typically high, so clearly I would say we are looking at high values above 50% of albedo. And albedo is a comparison between the radiation which reaches the satellite and the radiation which comes from the sun. So this is a simple rule. When you divide the two, so in terms of the solar constant, the radiation received by the satellite is a fraction. If it's close to 100, clearly it's thick cloud. If it's below, it's probably thin cloud. And of course, it depends on the channel. So different channels mean they measure different reflectivities because droplets or ice crystals respond differently to different wavelengths. Normally, small wavelengths like channel 1, 0.6 microns, let's say they are small and they go through the droplets in the cloud, so they reflect worse. Okay, so the values of reflectivity are lower, and you see that here in the blue line compared with the brown line, which is a bit higher reflectivity for 0.8 microns. This is characteristic of cloud. Channel 2 has a signal stronger than channel 1, but not very different. This is important when we talk about vegetation a bit later. And what happens in Madrid? Clouds or no clouds? Why do they have some reflectivity? Because of the ground having some albedo. Not as strong as a cloud, but yes, typically 30-40% are typical values for dry surfaces. If they are very vegetated and growing vegetation, the values go down. So we have values of 15%, 10%. Thick forest could be disappointingly low vegetation. Not disappointingly, but you expect it looks very green and very bright when you look from the side, but from space it's really very poor. I don't know how to stop this. I think it's close, but okay. Very good, yeah? Thank you. So, London has cloud, Madrid is clear. We could say many more things out of the differences between the two channels, which are, for me, the most important. 0.6, channel 1, 0.8, channel 2. You see the difference between the two lines, blue and brown, it's bigger for dry ground, okay, for any kind of ground, in fact, than for cloud. The two channels are similar. So, well, it all refers to the general theory, and the essential parameter we like to consider for reflectivity analysis is the size of what? The size of the particles which interact with the radiation. We measure this size compared with the wavelength of the radiation. So basically, it's the circumference of the obstacle divided by the wavelength, which gives us an indication of the amount of interaction. If it's close to one, it's a lot of interaction. If it's more or less, the interaction decreases. Optimally, around a value of 1, when this circumference here is similar to the wavelength of the radiation. And that's the case for cloud, because cloud and droplets are a few microns across in diameter, and the wavelengths we use are also 1 micron or more microns in the infrared. So that's why we see, not only with the visible, but with infrared, we see an lot of information from ground. We can tell in the solar channels and the thickness basically of the cloud, and in the infrared channels we can see, we can tell the temperature of the tops of the upper layer, which is normally enough to absorb all the radiation from the ground and emit radiation according to its temperature. On the other end of the behavior, we have these gases which are very, very small values of the size parameter, and this is approximated by Rayleigh approximation. This is just to simplify the formulas. Nowadays it's not a problem with computers, but in the past it was very heavy calculations to try to determine the amounts of radiation absorbed or scattered by any obstacles. I have to tell you, I'm receiving messages, I hope you are not seeing that, but it's coming to my nerves. Let me ask my expert colleague how to deactivate the notification for messages. And if there's some cancel server request, maybe, okay. And it doesn't respond, but okay. Any questions on this, or are you curious about it? Good, no special interest. So, let me ask you then to check if things are all right. If we are talking of dust particles in the infrared, which kind of regime are we talking about? Is it rather geometric or Rayleigh? So dust particles could be 1 micron in diameter, and the infrared is 10 microns. So the size is rather small. What do you think? We can treat it with Rayleigh equations or geometric equations. Yeah, rather Rayleigh. In fact, it's better to use the real equations, which are the Mie equations. Gustav Mie was a German physicist in the 19th century, when they thought the mankind or humankind had evolved to master science, and we were the lords or the ladies of nature. Well, we are far from that, but we are slowly managing to destroy our planet. Okay, so now I have lost control on the problem. No. Okay, so one thing which is important when we consider the surface is how much radiation we get from the surface. In the solar domain, we have the green arrows indicating how much radiation, let's say 100 units reach the top of the atmosphere. 20 of them are reflected back to space by the cloud. Some others are reflected by molecules, like here, the air. 6 of them, and 4 of them by the surface. So we are looking, and well, 51 are trapped, are absorbed by the surface of the Earth in the solar information. So we are left with only a component which is basically the cloud sending energy back into space. We can see clearly the cloud in our imagery, solar imagery, but we can see a bit of the surface. But look at this. The problem is we have cloud competing with us, so when we have cloud we cannot look at the surface, or we have to make very difficult computations to extract the cloud. And in addition, we have all the time some Rayleigh scattering, which is the molecules in the air competing with it. To our luck, well, it's more than what we get from the surface, actually. But we are lucky that this Rayleigh scattering is very uniform, so we can subtract it globally, so to say, as a uniform constant, which is subtracted. And we can look, we are looking at the 4% on average of the radiation which came from the sun when we use the solar channels. For the infrared, it's a bit different balance. So first of all, the radiation in the infrared is not coming from the sun at all. It's wavelengths around 10 microns, which coincide with the peak of radiation by an Earth at 300 Kelvin. And we have a component which is emitted by the ground and absorbed by the air. So this is not reaching the satellite. This is, we are blind to these amounts here. They are just there for the balance of energy. What we see is the radiation coming directly from the surface and the radiation coming directly from the air, because the air is in some spectral areas, spectral regions, of course, emitting radiation, which gets lost into space, and of course the cloud. So these two components, but again, the cloud is the most privileged element in the Earth for the satellites based on solar and infrared, as Mitya said. And again, we see this point on here. Air contributes more solar radiation to the satellite in the surface. We saw this here. And only 6 parts of 70 emitted by the surface, only 6 come from the surface into the satellite. The rest is absorbed at different places. And we have to distinguish between infrared radiation in blue coming from the surface and infrared radiation coming from the atmosphere. Again, we are almost losing in this game because it's only 6 against 64, but still we can say a lot of things thanks to Carla Barroso and her colleagues in the LAMSA. Any questions? This is a test. Normally you trust your eyes. It's a wonderful organ in our bodies, yeah? But sometimes we have to be careful, yes, because the brain is imposing a lot of assumptions. And the question here is maybe a bit obvious, but which pixels are darker? This around the letter B or this around the letter A? Please use your arrows, which are darker. B is darker. A is darker. And some other people. So far 1-1. Wow, opinions are divided. 2-2, one in the middle. Yeah, obviously. You are very good, yeah? I think you knew this from before. They are identical. If you take a sample from here, you take it to another part of the slide, and you take a sample from here, you will see it's precisely the same brightness, same color. So, that means for imagery, you might judge that you have the same color value in two different areas, but it very much depends on which colors you have around. So images are a good depiction globally, but in the end, if you want some numerical products, you have to go to measurements and so to the numbers behind. That's why, first of all, we have the gray renderings for some maps, and that's relatively good, but it's not good enough by itself. So we can take the radians or the albedos from 0 to 100 and stretch them uniformly as a gray value. That's a first step, but there's always, you know, that from modern cameras, the gamma correction and many other corrections needed to have a sharp, very beautiful image. That means we don't put 50 in the middle, but we put something like 20, and we sort of enhance the low values, which are more frequently shown in the image. So we have a better rendering better depiction of what's happening there. And finally, because of our brain, we have the big advantage of using colors. And this is a technique called slicing, color slicing. That means, okay, I'm interested in the ocean, which has a very low reflectivity, let's say between 0 and 10%. So just for those values, I use a lot of colors, and then I distinguish areas, and maybe I guide my ships to fish areas or whatever fish it is. Who knows? Maybe the plankton appears there and makes it a bit higher albedo. And this is a good indication. You see a bit of structure in the fields, in the ocean albedo, which is not present, is not easy to identify in the black and white images. Another technique parallel to that is slicing, but very different, is to merge information from several channels into a single color image. For that, we take each of the channels assigned, let's say three channels, and assign each of them a color. So instead of black and white, we make it red and black, from red to black, from green to black, and from blue to black. And in the end, the result is a magic image, which resembles something which we seem to identify intuitively as vegetation or dry areas. Be careful, because in this case we don't have actually the same sensors as in the eye, as I said, solar channels, but not human sensors. And that means we are not looking at the same spectral area. It's all solar, but different wavelengths. That means some cases, if you go to Google Earth or something and explore these areas, you might find a lot of trees here, which doesn't look, they do not look to exist. Could be because they are not growing. As I said, these channels are sensitive to, especially channel 2, at 0.8 microns, is very sensitive to vegetation growth. But it could be because the association of brown with dry areas is not correct for this choice of EUMETSAT channels. And you can look at the differences. And this is like a very cheap formula, let's say, for obtaining a map of vegetation. First of all, it's based on the fact that the difference between channels 0.6, 0.8 for cloud was small, as I said before. You remember in London. And the difference, if I take the difference here, the difference map, pixel by pixel, I'm going to exclude those pixels because they have a low value. So I enhance just in color values which are a bit higher for the difference between 25% and 50%, and that will be my vegetation map. You see the highest values in red are here, some dots in England, and the green are still big. So those are areas of vegetation growth. But of course, there are better techniques. But this is a very cheap solution, very easy to implement by software. It's just a difference between two channels, which is very common in dealing with satellite imagery. Any questions? An alternative to that cheap formula is to look at several channels as the basis. Well, this is a three-color composite based on solar channels of EUMETSAT, but this is a graph analyzing two areas. Basically, this vegetated area in Central Africa, close to, I don't know if Cedric is around, well, the Cameroon is here, but it could be a similar vegetation ground or soil, and another area which is desertic area. If we look at the differences, we notice high values for both channels in the desertic area and low values in both channels with bigger difference between the two in the vegetation area. So when we look at this well-known vegetation index, the difference divided by the addition, we have for vegetation a relatively big difference and small addition because the two values are small. So we have a big value. That's why it's called vegetation. And for this case, we have big values in the denominator and small difference in the numerator, so it's a low value. If you additionally have cloud, the cloud will add to the, well, will make this difference small, so it will be discarded by itself as an area with vegetation. It's not possible. Now wake up. I am going to ask you to, I don't know if you can write a number, make an estimate of the vegetation index, let's say here. Okay, for, do you see my red dot? So just use the formula below and tell me roughly what's the value resulting. You can type it in the chat box. It's a number between 0 and 1, so, well, it could be negative, but only for the oceans. So I'm helping a bit. Channel 0.8, 25%. Channel 0.6, 10%. So you take those values to the formula and you get a vegetation index of, okay. Very good, yeah, 43%, sometimes you say. Excellent, and who wants to calculate here for the desert area? Percent for 0.8, 50% for 0.6. Okay, very good. Good. So it's around 9% or 10%. Good. Let's move. We could analyze for a set of points with different scenes what those values are. Actually, it's normal to put a difference here. The difference is already here. And actually, one simplification I don't like is to say, okay, I have two channels of 0.6, 0.8. I can derive the vegetation index. It's not only one vegetation index, it's two. Because you have two pieces of information, you should not give one away just for free. So the two are important. Actually, vegetation in this kind of diagram, vegetation index is measured by the slope. So if you have a value here, you go to the origin. This slope is high, so it's more vegetation than this. And well, I cannot, well, I'm showing the answer in my original PowerPoint, it wasn't there. But basically, what you have here is high values in one of the channels corresponding to the snow on the mountains, and low values in the difference because there's no, well, it shows little difference between the two. In both cases, high values. And this this part of here, this is low values, which is this piece of ocean here. You can see that. And the rest is roughly vegetated, but, well, as I said before, this is the slope, and these pixels are a bit drier than these ones. But it's probably not a time for a lot of vegetation in the area. It's April, maybe it's early for having any vegetation growing. Well, this is a bit more complicated. I wanted to share, let me go and show you. The application I hope you can see now. I'm going to travel from, let's say, this pixel over the ocean to, well, somewhere here. And I get this sort of graph, which means for channel 3 at 1.6, I'm going to simplify first of all, just to make it less confusing with so many lines. So I have two lines. The green one is 0.8 and the blue one is 0.6. And you see, as I said before, 0.8 is always giving values of albedo higher than 0.6, except for the ocean. The ocean part is close to A, which is this area, this line. I'm like cutting the two channels across and creating pixel by pixel what the values are in the two channels. And you see first an area where the differences are small. Sorry, the difference between the two values is high, but the values are relatively small. And this is vegetated area. This is typical for the vegetation. And when I move to more desertic areas or less vegetated areas, the values go up, and the difference between the two, I don't know if you see my cursor, and the difference between the two on the right-hand side for the region EF, for instance, is reducing. So that's precisely as we want it. You can do a lot of analysis here in this particular image. If you can see, I don't know if you can annotate with your arrows, but there's something special here. Is there not in the area of close to Sudan? What do you see there, close to the Red Sea? It's something whitish. Do you think the ground is different there, or why is it different? Any ideas? I don't know if I can see you. Okay, well, I can disclose this. And so this is an area of dust in the atmosphere which changes the properties of the ground. So the albedo gets enhanced, is higher for these areas because of the dust in the atmosphere, especially above areas with vegetation, tropical areas. You notice an increase of the albedo values. But you don't know precisely where the limits of this dust in the atmosphere are, because the ground is similar in values of albedo. So it's just a modification of the basic ground albedo due to dust. That's an important effect. Stop sharing this, and I hope you're back with me in the presentation. So what I was going to say, if we consider the other channel, which we have not considered, 1.6, what happens? We have two areas at B and at C. They are quite different for sure from in terms of vegetation. We never exploited them, but why not try? Because it's a very good index of vegetation too. So I would say channel 1.6 is very high for surfaces with sand. So it's a bit of a silicate indication in the ground. So that's good for characterizing the ground. And when you have this situation, channel 3, 1.6, has values higher than channel 2, as you see in this graph in B. In C, you have negative values, so that means channel 2 is stronger. And this is a good index for dryness in the ground. Talking of a new index, which can be defined in an analogous way to the vegetation index to measure the dryness, or even, we will see maybe in one example, the snow on the ground. And this is the difference between 3 and 2 divided by the addition of the two channel albedos. And this separates B, desertic areas, from C, vegetated areas, because of this difference. Changes sign in this case. Okay, that's an important possible application of these channels, which I'm just surprised didn't happen so far. And I want to move to the next. Okay, so I was talking of this perhaps room available for another vegetation index. So we have three solar channels in the EUMETSAT. Why do we use just one index? Sometimes two. I think the landsat is using more of that information, of course, the three of them. But do not forget that you can use all three channels from the solar domain, and you can use infrared channels, because when there's no cloud, you can measure emissivities there of the ground, which depend on the evolution of the harvest. On the basis of these applications is always the continuous observation of satellite values. So you have to compare, let's say, 1 year in May with the previous years in May, so you can tell what's happening, what's your forecast then for the harvest, on the evolution of different kinds of soil. So it's the matter itself is for agrometeorologists, but it's certainly something which requires continuous dedication. But the applications are there, and the problem is they are not yet developed, and we are almost running out of this second generation. The third generation is already coming. Well, I guess you have read about this before, so it's the professionals. I was showing some amateur applications, but the land surface analysis south, the satellite applications facility based in Lisbon, Portugal, is dealing with many of these quantities here, the amount of relief area index, the fraction of vegetation cover, surface albedos, and global albedos, I guess, in this case, fire radiative powers, etc. It's a lot, a big collection of images, and it's already gone through the algorithm, so you don't have to do the calculation, but still you have to compare values from, let's say, today and 1 year ago to realize what's the difference. So a little exercise, what do you think is this little area at the tip of the green arrow? Which of these categories apply? I can hint, is not cloud, but cloud is not an option. Could it be smoke? Probably smoke. Why should it be restrained to the land area? No, I would say it's not smoke. Cirrus, I say it's not cloud. And why it should follow the coastline. Sand, it's a possibility. Fog, okay, this is maybe day. The area is, if you live there, it's very, very hot. No chance for fogs. And I think Nuno Lopez is correct. This is greenhouse areas for tomatoes, actually it's the first region in Europe in production of tomato production. So this is the glass, that makes it a bit bright on reflection for the channel, which covers most of the visible domain and most of the solar domain too. Okay, this is a bit more specialized, and I think we should be coming to an end, so I will quickly show you the effect of humidity on the ground. This is a picture in May, and then in August, first in May you have flooded areas where the rice is growing, and then in the Po Valley you have the rice fields already with the rice grown up. Compared with the bare soil, which is browner, you have a good indication of the evolution in these intermediate months. You have better imagery than EUMETSAT, of course, in OLCH is one of the instruments, and Sentinel 3, which is available from the web for all of you. The passes is a polar orbiter, so the passes are twice a day, and because of of the night, which is not useful for the satellite, for the photology, concentrating on in wavelengths in between 0.4 and 1 micron, I think. So it's just more for ocean monitoring, ocean color, and for surface monitoring, in this case, the Nile River, in banks which are more or less flooded, and the water in these reservoirs in the upper part of the river. Okay, this is theoretical considerations. And this is a solar image at night. So, well, I put it in blue, but actually, it is what generates the images. It's good, even if it's night. Because, why is it good? Because you are looking at fires now. If you look carefully, I hope your resolution is as good as mine. You see dots here, 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 here. They are much easier to look at in a channel which contains emitted radiation from the Earth. It's night, but there's the radiation from the Earth, and that's 3.9. I cannot see that here, but I tell you. Well, the corresponding image in 3.9 indicates the same big fires on these dots. So you are looking at dots in 1.6. And here again, for the fires in Portugal, October 2017, devastating fires with causing victims and a lot of death. And the satellite channel at 1.6 was able to actually show some signal. It was very, very large fires. Carol can tell more in detail. Well, this is a more advanced topic indicating that it's not only, well, in the theory, solar is reflective radiation and infrared is emitted radiation, but you can have a mixture, especially in those channels close to the boundary between the two regions, respective regions. In this case, volcanoes, lava, which is very hot, can show again in 1.6 and has a very strong red component. Okay, so I'm tempted to stop because I must be sleeping already. I have no indicator unless a new website for the Landsat, so this should be an exercise to look at that. I will do later. But it's important just to refer to the surface to indicate how I showed some difference between the snow on the ground and cloud before. I said it was dendritic structure. It's not only structure. If you look at several channels at the same time, you have a cloud, but you have an area of snow on the ground. Can you guess where with your arrows? Please, it's just a guess, but please indicate snow on the ground, no cloud above. So I was right that you are sleeping. Luna deserves a special mention. He's always okay. Very good, yes. So this special red color, let me delete, is indicating snow on the ground. And here, of course, these patches. And the ice cloud, so cloud with ice tops, is more peach color, orange. So, my summary. Well, there was another mention of these three different grounds. No cloud in this case. This is granitic type of soil. This is desert, sandy, and this is vegetated. And you see, for the three channels, first of all, the evolution in the day in the infrared. So they get warm, but the red one, the vegetated one, has a moderate heating during the day, in the course of the day. So this is 280, so 7 degrees, and it goes up to 23. But of course, for the desert, the jump in values is higher, especially for the granitic one. Well, you see the difference in the inertia. The sand has a longer inertia, traps the radiation a bit longer, and cools slower than the granite. in blue here at B. And for the solar information, well, the basic difference is in the red, which is the vegetation jumps from for 0.6, the values are low, for 0.8, they jump quite a lot in this vegetated area. And this was for the snow index I introduced before, 3, in this case minus 1 divided by 3 plus 1. And then you see clearly in black the snow areas. Sometimes it's not only snow on the ground, okay, it's not a perfect one, but it's a good approximation. And the jump in the vegetation in the this time of the year, roughly. So you see, this was April, actually not this year, but this is now the case. It's much, much greener when you look at these color composites. The last point is for sunglint, something which is like a noise introduced by the sun. When it reflects like on a mirror, the ocean could be mirror, you have an area with values which are much higher. You see them increase in general from CDE, and this is due to the direct sun reflection onto the satellite sensors. This is not valid for well, for many applications, but that's one application where it could be used. And what do you think makes these values brighter in this area? Let's say all of them are uniformly brighter because of the sun, but why some of them are brighter? Because of what? And my question is it because of dust, because of wind, or because of cloud? What do you think? You can write in the chat. Cloud, dust, or wind, does it making the difference between some pixels here and some other pixels? Dust is a possibility, but actually the wind making and creating roughness on the ocean surface is the main factor in these changes in values you can perceive here, changes. These changes up and down, it's not much, but it's 5% in albedo for the three channels. These are due to wind, so they are areas with wind and without wind. If you have any questions, go ahead now. And this sunglint occurs actually in an area which is between the point of vertical sun and the point, the subsatellite point. You know, it's in the middle of it. So the relation to the sunglint, the location depends on the sun. And you know the sun goes from the northern hemisphere to the southern hemisphere in February, October, September, December. So you have the sunglint area localized for every day of the year and for every time of the year. This is, for instance, the 20th of December. You have at 2 UTC, this is the night, the UTC, you can see sunglint in these areas, 11 UTC, 12 UTC, 15 UTC. This is from Mediaset. So if you have some at 10 UTC in October, 20th of October, sunglint here on the rivers, you will see some very strong signal in the solar channels. This is sunglint, nothing to do with fires. Sometimes the automatic algorithm for fire detection says, okay, there's a fire here in the river. Okay, no, it's not true, it's an artifact, it's a result of using algorithms blindly. And, well, at some times of the year, especially close to the solstices, in this case it's the summer solstice, look at the date, 20th of June, but it's midnight, and you have a strong signal in the solar channels. 3 to 1 is the composite. What's that? That's Well, surprisingly, the inclination of the Earth is towards the sun, and even during the night, it hits parts of the, in this case, Iceland, and goes to the satellite, which is on the other side, midnight, yeah, in each, with a lot of very strong signal. That means there's no cloud there, it's probably flat water surface above, no, let's say north of Iceland. And this is another kind of sunglint for polar satellites. They have the sun on the back, so to say, and they get moving sunglint. Of course, the satellite is scanning line by line and progressing at the same time. So you have like a line, and the surface affected is smaller because it's much closer to the Earth than the geostationary satellites. And well, here you see over the oceans, you have maybe salt or maybe dust, which creates this magenta sort of color in conjunction with the sunglint. So what happens? The sunglint goes directly, but the component, well, magenta is the opposite of green, so the green is missing, so there's no reflection for 0.6 and no reflection on the ocean for 1.6, so the result is this pink. And this is the high reflectivity for the rivers in Africa, River Congo. In this case, nothing to do with fires. This is another sunglint, different times, but basically you can see, it's almost like, well, this is a strong enhancement. An image you enhanced strongly can look like having cloud. It's not cloud, it's the wind field over the ocean. So you can look at that with the analysis of the sunglint, especially at different times, as the case is for this image. Okay, this is on dust, as it doesn't belong to the presentation today, but basically what it shows is that some parts of the ocean are very much affected by dust, so the reflectivity of the dust is very low, so you make it grow with the dust, and the growth is measuring channel 2, for instance, in the horizontal, 0.8 microns. And you see more and more dust, whiter and whiter image here, and you can analyze out of these curves what's the amount of dust. Not so much the height, because solar is blind to height, but you have the infrared for that, and you can analyze the height of the dust with the infrared channel, so you have a more or less complete depiction on the distribution of dust above, especially above the oceans. The forward scattering of the radiation is a situation which happens when the sun hits something on the Earth and reflects forward to the satellite. And this is a much more favorable situation due to the physics behind than the backward scattering, which is very poor. So at late in the afternoon at point E, at the east of the EUMETSAT imagery, for instance, you have a situation of backwards scattering, which is poor in radiation, let's say, this is not very strong, compared with the early morning situation. So the solar is there, so it's going to show higher values, as in this example. So sunrise, well, this is the west, so it's the opposite of what I explained, but similar concept. So it's not much for this smoke over here, it's not much reflection at sunrise, but at sunset you have a strong reflection. Of course, the smoke was not created in the intervening hours, so it's something which is there, but you see better or worse depending on the sun illumination conditions. Next day again, not so bright. Well, actually you can play sleuths, how do you say, detectives, to find the source of this dust. But this is you have to look at the thicker and bigger dust, and well, that changes depending on, well, you can analyze that if you have time, and the presentation will be there. And you come to the conclusion Bolivia is the cause of this smog, which every September fills the air in South America with smog. It's really unpleasant. Okay, I think you suffered enough. I excuse you from the rest of this presentation. Solar channels are very interesting for the surface analysis. Infrared can be used. I didn't emphasize that so much. But anyway, for the third generation, starting 2022 or 23, we will have double as many solar channels as we have now in the second generation. So it's promising to look at 1.3, which is going to give us zero indications, 0.9 in each channel for analyzing both the surface and the atmosphere, and 2.2 aerosols, and to build the colors we see with our eyes, we will have 0.4 and 0.5 together with 0.6. It will be something similar to our brain analysis of reality through the senses in the eye. Then you can call these three real or a true color composite. Thank you, and we look forward to some questions. If I cannot believe you have absorbed everything I said, but maybe you're curious about some of the points, I don't mind to repeat or to discuss anything.